to Gab Street.
We got video now.
We got video. Hopefully. We're here. We're actually here for you to look at.
If this is up on YouTube and you can actually see us, then it worked. But if not, then it didn't work. And yeah, we're just trying to figure stuff out.
Yeah, so we might have just lied to you. That's a possibility. So, you know, it's whatever. We do have a guest here, but
before
we'll get to him in a minute.
Introduce him.
So just sit tight. We're going to run through some messages that we have prepared. First, we would like to make one exciting new announcement about sponsorship stuff. We have a new sponsor, and they go by KT. You might have seen them at the German Village Makers Market. They do one every other month. They have a stand there that they normally do. So they make really, really good tea. I talked about them in episode 13.
Probably.
I went on a tangent. No. That was episode 12. I went on a tangent about them and how good.
You go on a lot of tangents.
I go on a lot of
track.
Yeah. There's too many to count. No tally marks here. But we have eventually been provided with tea to drink on episodes and all that. And we'll be pushing that stuff pretty hard.
They give us stuff, we promote them, so...
Exactly. It's a nice little exchange of values, you know what I mean?
We got the Green Room,
Once again.
They've been helping us out for the last few episodes. It's a shop coming out late 2019, similar to a Spencer's of Waterbeds or stuff, if you've ever been to one of those shops. Featuring products from tobacco products to t-shirts, you can find a bunch of stuff like that. So yeah, the Green Room is the name, and for getting their name out there, they've been helping us with the distribution fees so that you guys can listen to us on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, which seem to be our two most popular, besides YouTube, Podbean, everything else that we're on.
Gotta get those analytics, you know what I mean?
Yes, yeah. Gotta let everybody listen. Everybody's gotta listen.
Everybody's gotta check it out.
Apparently not everybody is down to listen to podcasts on YouTube, because people want to be able to shut their phone off.
That's true.
Put it in their pocket.
You don't want to buy YouTube Premium to listen to music with your phone shut off. It's stupid.
Yeah. Just go ahead and pay $10 a month for Spotify. Anyway.
Exactly.
You get music too. And you get to listen to us. All right.
We have one more message. Today's transition music is provided by... Hold on. They are called...
Transition Music.
They are called Transition Music. Oh, God.
We've come prepared this episode.
We have come prepared. Fortune Orange. Yes, Fortune Orange.
I was trying to remember the name,
and they are providing our music today. Yes, I talked to them, and they are like, yeah. So we're going to have that stuff between topics today, and it's going to be really cool.
We got to figure out what kind of pop-up we're going to have during the...
Yeah, I didn't think about that.
I'll come up with something.
That's going to be preparation for later.
We'll figure it
out. Yep, we're geniuses over here at Gab Street. Yeah. Or also, as you said last episode, or two episodes ago, Fucktard Fairway.
Fucktard Fairway.
So that's another alternative we can go with.
Yes. We have a guest.
We do have a guest. His name is...
Kenneth.
Jackson.
Jackson.
So, Kenneth Jackson, would you like me to introduce what you do, or would you like to talk about what you do?
You go for it.
Okay, cool. So, Kenneth Jackson... is a man that I have known since...
I am a man.
He is a man. And he's sitting right there, and he's sitting across the TV tray from me.
We weren't joking when we said that we are literally sitting in lawn chairs in a TV tray. This is it.
The real deal. And lawn chairs, folks. This is real. I don't have any other furniture. So, I met Kenneth in 2017. It was December of 2017. Mm-hmm. And I told a story about this event. Two episodes ago, I think. Or was it story time last episode? I don't remember.
So I've already been mentioned on the podcast?
Not episode? You specifically. Oh, okay. I mentioned meeting Milo.
Oh, so not me, though.
That
I wasn't important.
I'm sorry. We wanted to wait for to
build the suspense.
Exactly. Yeah. We gotta. You know how you save the best for last.
We're not very good hype men.
Yeah, we're not. We're not wingmen of any kind. But you're a concert photographer in the city of Columbus. You take a lot of photos of small shows, big shows, mainly hip-hop. Do you do any other shows?
I have done a few, yeah. Okay. There was one Now I'm trying to remember their name. I feel bad. I can't remember the name.
Fortune Orange, am I right?
It was not Fortune Orange. There was a punk band that liked some of the photos I posted on Instagram.
Okay.
Because I used to use like generic Columbus related hashtags, and I think they had browsed those.
Was that the one that and broke they, up?
I don't know.
Or okay, no, there. Go on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, this band liked my photos so much that I sent them a DM and was like, "Hey, thanks for your support. You know, if you guys ever want photos of a show, let me know." And they were like, "Yeah, that'd be cool." And then they hit me up, and I was like, "Okay." So I mean, I went out and shot people with guitars and, you know, singing, and it was a Roomba, just like the show.
Nice. Where
we
okay.
met. Cool. So yeah, I've shot them, and then there's another music photographer in town named Lindsay Jordan.
Okay.
Was really talented, and she actually also turns out is a recording artist doing country, so that was a very different experience than the hip hop shows.
Yeah,
she was amazing. So yeah, just to plug her, Lindsay, J O R D S on Instagram.
Always got to do the shout outs. Very nice,
Lindsay with an A.
Big respect.
Yeah.
Yes. Awesome.
But other than that, it's pretty much been exclusively hip hop, and you know, like R&B artists that get mixed into hip hop shows.
Cool. Is there a reason why you kind of focus more on hip hop than you do? Like, is it just?
That's just the kind of music I like.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
And you met Sam Rothstein first, right?
When yeah.
You
moved well, here? Yeah. So he's the first person that I kind of had an ongoing conversation with. Actually, I think the very first person I ever met was Raiden Labs.
Okay.
And Kale DeCue. Have you ever met him?
I haven't met him, but I know who that guy is.
Yeah, I don't know if he's as active lately as he was when I first started out. Obviously, Raiden's still active.
Yeah.
But yeah, they were actually one of the very first pictures I have is the two of them standing in front of a wall.
Nice. That's cool.
And I felt very awkward. I went up to them and was like, "Hey, I like the color of your shirts on this wall. Can I take a picture?" And they were like, "Yeah, okay." And then I took a picture and walked away because I was so shy and unsure of myself.
That's how you got to start, though.
Right.
I mean, we started this podcast by just walking up to people and, you know, just recording them against the wall. No, I'm just kidding. That's not what we did.
And then walking away awkwardly. Yeah.
Just walking away.
Right.
Yeah. So, you moved here a few years ago, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So I went to grad school here from 2011 to 13, and never went to any shows of any kind back then.
Okay.
Actually, I did go see Bare Naked Ladies at Express Live. Completely unrelated to this.
That's cool.
Anyway, so then I moved to D.C. for about 3.5 years. So when I finished my grad program, I couldn't get a job. So I went there. And then once I had enough experience, and same with my wife, we were able to move back because we really liked Columbus. So
cool.
And yeah, I was always into hip-hop since undergrad. And let's see. So I moved back January... like late January 2017. And then one day at work, I was like, I listen to a lot of hip hop, but I never go into any shows. Like, maybe I should see what kind of shows are out there. Have you guys heard of Soundset Festival?
I have. In
Minnesota? Yeah. And just happened to stumble across them. I don't remember how. Maybe I was just searching like hip hop festivals.
As you do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I went up there in May of that year and, you know, really enjoyed that festival. Got to see a lot of cool acts. And then I was like, well, this is all the way in Minnesota. Maybe there's stuff going on closer to home, and found 2x2 Fest.
Yeah.
Which is where I went, met Raiden Labs. he is a man, not a woman. speaking of people being men.
Shout out Maiden Labs.
Yeah, shout out to Maiden Labs.
Also shout out Josh Miller for setting up 2x2 Hip Hop Fest. I volunteered there for a few years. None of us can talk today. And
it's a collective stroke we're all just having.
I have yet to actually just go. I've been volunteering every year. So I think this year I'm just going to kind of like see what's happening. Mm-hmm. So
yeah,
that might be cool. Yeah.
So yeah, so to elaborate a little on kind of how I met Sam and everything. So that year I went, you know, met a few people, shot, you know, a bunch of the openers. Was really impressed with what Sam did on stage.
He's a great live show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I got one of his mixtapes after the show and very briefly said hello. Like, we didn't really talk at all because, once again, I was like... I kind of, when I first started out, thought that these people, not to, like, insult them, but I thought they were bigger than they are, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, well, they're performing on the stage. Like, they must be really important rappers. It's like, I don't want to bother them. Now I know, like, Sam's really approachable, and same with Raiden and everybody else. Almost everybody else. Some people are weird. not to name names, but... So then after, you know, I met Sam, I just hit him up and was like, hey, you know, do you know of any local shows? I'd love to start, you know, kind of getting involved with the scene. And he pointed me to a show at 129 Studios down in Franklinton. You guys ever been there?
No, but
it's like it's a small art gallery. It's pretty close to Rehab Tavern, if you've ever been there for shows.
I think I might know what you're talking about.
Yeah, it's like around the corner from Rehab. Cool. And, you know, it just kind of started branching out from there. Mm-hmm. At that show, shot a bunch of people. Cassius Keys.
Cassius Keys is dope. Shout out Cassius.
Yes. Trigno was there.
Nice.
Have you guys ever heard of Isoja?
Yeah.
Okay, he was there. I mean, it was pretty much like a who's who of a lot of the people I follow now. We're at that very first show.
Cool.
Yeah. Sweet. So that's kind of how I got started.
Nice.
Yeah. And, sorry if I'm dominating the conversation.
Go ahead. No, go ahead. We want you to talk as much as possible.
Yeah, yes. So like music photography, kind of more generally, kind of how did I get into that at all? I'd been shooting just random stuff kind of from undergrad all the way through like 2012? But 2014. So after I moved to DC, I just had like a relatively nice point and shoot, but like not a fancy DSLR or anything. and then finally got a DSLR, still a crop sensor, but started kind of dabbling in like shooting nature and like kind of stuff on the street in Washington, D.C., because there's a lot going on, you know, protests and festivals and things, not music, but and then so that kind of led into doing weddings, did that for a while, and then was still doing weddings when I moved here, but not really getting a lot of traction. I think I was a decent wedding photographer, but not great. And I realized I didn't care enough about what I was doing to like invest the work to get great, which I felt like that was needed to get the business going that I wanted to get.
Yeah.
I need to get better. Do I really care enough to get better? Maybe not. So that's kind of how I started doing music, because I was like, well, what else could I try? And I already like hip hop. I like taking pictures. Maybe I should check out if that's a thing to do. So,
cool.
Yeah. Body go. You should let your body go.
Let your worries hurry out the door. Do you dabble in any music creation of your own?
So I saw that question on Corey Leaked the question list to me. I actually do have some tracks me and my friends made in high school and college.
Yeah, there we go.
But I'm not going to share that with anyone. That's top secret. I mean, if you find it, kudos. But
I'm making that the transition music.
Yeah. Maybe I'll send you a
sorry,
track.
Sorry, Fortune Orange, you're out here.
You can leak it into this episode, like, surreptitiously and not mention it was mine.
Well, we'll just edit that part out.
I was just like random stuff with like keyboards we found at thrift stores.
Nice.
And like a little like $3 little lapel mic from Radio Shack.
Nice.
Like just plugged into the computer using like Windows Music Editor or something.
So, yeah, just like a voice recorder.
Yeah, voice recorder. That was my jam back in the day. Yeah, so yeah.
Nice. And I noticed that on your Instagram you shoot a lot of mainly black and white photography. Is there a reason that you choose to shoot more in black and white than in color? Is it just the aesthetic that you enjoy more? Or is...
So honestly, it's laziness.
Okay.
Yeah. So at a lot of these shows, the lighting isn't great. It's like really dark.
Yeah.
And sometimes the colors are really intense. Like you get almost neon looking greens or blues or reds.
Gotcha.
And there are a lot of music photographers who are really skilled at, you know, working Lightroom and Photoshop, like manipulating the colors and tones to make it look like something that's good. But I've never forced myself to learn that. So often if I'm shooting a show and the lighting's really bad and I get home and I'm like, this isn't going to look very good in color, then I just throw it all to black and white.
That's kind of how
it goes. And it seemed
they
like...
They still look good.
Yeah, thanks. They look great, yeah.
It seemed like people on Instagram liked the black and whites I was posting more.
Mm-hmm.
So as I noticed that, I was like, well, you know, I guess that's not a problem. I'll just, like, make the ratio higher.
Yeah.
And as I've gotten a little better at dealing with low-light situations, I've, like, been able to save color. on more shows. So I've experimented with sharing, like, you know, more color versus black and white. So I kind of go back and forth.
Gotcha.
So, cool. Yeah, I feel like it, with the color photos, unless it's really vivid and interesting color,
yeah,
people tend to like the black and white version more. It's just what I've known from, like, likes, which, you know, whoever knows how important that metric is. But if you're judging by that alone, yeah.
Gotcha.
If the immediate reaction is to double tap the screen,
right,
that means you succeeded, obviously.
Right.
It's just the way to...
That's what you're going for.
If you,
although they're about to get rid of that. I'm assuming you guys heard that or no?
Mm-hmm. What is it?
What?
Instagram is considering eliminating like counts visibly.
I did hear about that. Yeah, they're like... I honestly don't really know how I feel about that. I feel like it's...
I don't either.
I think it can... I see why they would do it, because it's like... It means that more people don't really have, I guess, it's attempting to take away that social pressure of getting likes every time you put out something.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, I feel like as long as they keep comments, I think it's okay. Mm-hmm. Are they planning on keeping comments, do you know?
Yeah, I don't think the comment number is going to be visible either. Like, right now, you can see, without expanding it, 26 comments.
Yeah.
Okay. When you click on it. So I don't think it, I mean, I guess it would just say comments, and you click it, and then you can see them all.
That's a fair point, but I have a quick hot take.
Mm.
This would allow people to buy followers very easily.
Yeah, which I've seen someone comment, and almost wondered, like I wondered in a Twitter conversation, is this why they did that? Like, are there some famous people who have bought a lot of followers and obviously have little engagement? Who are like, hey, Instagram, could you help us out here? And so they're like, okay, we'll hide it. And now no one can tell that you're faking it.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, because I think the whole point of... Didn't they used to have dislikes on Instagram?
I don't know. I've never seen that. Although I haven't been on it for that many years, so maybe they did.
Or maybe I've just been spending a lot of time on Reddit.
Maybe. Yeah, you can downvote on Reddit.
Yeah. Right. For some reason... I was thinking that there used to be dislikes on Instagram. I might be wrong about
just
that.
Just not liking it.
I mean, I think
the way you dislike something on Instagram is if it's a video and you give it a view, but you don't like it.
Hmm.
Because you see, like, well, 70,000 views, and then it's, like, 2 likes.
Yeah, because if you tap on the, like, view count, you can see how many people...
Yeah.
Like, who has liked it.
And it's always very different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know why they don't have that, like, side by side. Why would,
I know.
Yeah. It's weird how they have to, like, they have the view count, but they don't, you have to, like, click on that to see your like count.
I have to, like, move my fingers.
And it's like, I've got, really there's, upset. Like, everything's hidden under fucking panels. fucking Nakey Jakey video where he's just constantly complaining about how, like, video game, like, UIs now are just, like, panels, and, like, how, like, Windows is now just, like, panels and everything.
Yeah.
Under...
True. Let's talk about video games. No, let's not talk about video games.
We've turned into an IGN podcast.
Oh, God. No.
They have, like, 1,000 podcasts, dude.
10 out of 10. It was okay. It could have been better.
My favorite thing right now is that if you go on Apple Music and you look at our rating... We have 5 stars, and our buddy Emerson left a comment that says, better than sex, pretty entertaining podcast, 5 out of 5. And I love how it's like you go to the comments, it's just the only one there, and it just says better than, in the title, and the subject is just better than sex, pretty entertaining podcast.
Hmm. Shout out to Emerson, you're a real G. Also,
those seem a little bit conflicting. Better than sex, pretty entertaining. Like, not to be crude, but sex is pretty good. I don't know if I'd call sex pretty entertaining. I think I'd say it was better than pretty entertaining. Anyway.
We'll have to talk to him about that. Let's get into semantics here.
He's conflicted.
But I do have a quick little message that I forgot to say at the beginning. We do have a new way for the listeners to support us. It is called Ko-fi. You have to type in ko-fi.
Like lo-fi. Ko-fi.
Lo-fi hip-hop.
Ko-fi hip-hop.
Ko-fi hip-hop. So our link is ko-fi.com/GabStreetPodcast, all one word. And what you can do there is it's kind of like Patreon, but it's a one-time donation of $3. It buys you a cup of coffee. Coffee. You get it? You get it? It's funny. It's like, Yeah. It's rather clever. I started listening to Pre-Dead Boys lately, which is another Columbus podcast. Shout out to those guys. But I noticed they had a Ko-fi page, and they get some support on there. So if you guys really like what we do, and you have $3 to spare, we would love if you do that.
And this is more than just, like, us asking people for money.
Yeah.
This is, like, so that, you know, maybe we don't always have to use a TV tray and lawn chairs, you know? Because if we could buy some cushions,
yeah,
that'd be nice.
If we could get a little more comfort in here,
yeah,
this would be better, you know? Yeah, be cool.
Just help us out so that we can get some nicer stuff.
Yeah.
And then we can make better content that you guys can enjoy.
Like videos.
Yes, back to Kenneth.
Mm. So, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Just real quick. And I'm putting you on the spot a little bit. And so, I apologize. It's a bit of a hard question. Right. But I'm going to start asking this of every creative.
I swear to God, if you ask old Kanye or new Kanye.
It's not that. I'm not bringing that back right now. I will eventually. I'm going to sneak it in when you don't remember, but not right now. So, Kenneth, what makes you unique in the world of concert photography?
Yeah, I saw that question and I was like, oh, what am I going to say with this? I don't know. That'd be my honest answer. Is that answer allowed? No.
No.
I got to come up with something.
Yeah, I'm putting you on the hot seat right now.
Just bullshit something.
Yeah, just completely, like, you wrote it smudged on your hand, like, just whatever.
I mean, I guess I'm thinking of the cliche phrase of, like, well, I'm me and no one else is me.
Fuck it. I guess that works.
But that still feels like a cop-out, so let me see. What would I say?
I could help you out, too.
I guess I like shooting with no flash. I know that's still not super unique, but a lot of people shoot with flash, especially like direct flash that's pointed at the person. Mm-hmm. That seems to be very popular in hip-hop now.
Seriously?
Yeah, at least a lot of the people I follow on Instagram.
Concert photography in general.
I feel like I would throw them off a lot, and they would, like, hate that. I feel like it would just, they'd see it, and they're like, bah, like, what the hell?
Yeah, I mean, that's what
I'm rapping here, like, you know.
That would be my guess, too, but it seems to be a popular style, especially, like, portraits.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of hip-hop portraits I see are, like, the flash is, like, pointed right at Gage's face.
And then they're blind afterward.
Yeah.
It's great.
So I mean, maybe that's a different style choice.
Okay.
That's cool. I tend to like very simple compositions, which maybe is a bad thing. Sometimes I wonder if I should push myself to like branch out. But I feel like my shots tend to be kind of minimal. Like, here's the performer and there's like nothing around them.
Simplicity has its value though. Take Minecraft, for example. It's a very simple game. Mm. It's done very well. Mm-hmm. I think... Terrible example. I'm an asshole. But if you, like, I think that people are so, with the digital age now, bombarded by everything that's super complicated. And it's like, look at all these cool little things I can smash together. Mm. And it's like a symphony of sounds and images, and you're just like, oh God, I can't handle this. Like, I can only take one at a time. But it's very easy to, like, I see your catalog of your stuff as more of a piece on its own as the whole, if that makes any sense. Like, if you were to look at, like, a Renaissance painting or something, like, I don't know, the dude is naked and he's, like, trying to, like, touch God or whatever. Like, if you're looking at that, there's a lot of...
You sound like such a pretentious asshole by saying that. The dude where he's, like, touching...
He's, like, the dude and he's, like...
That was
know,
a great
like...
description of Creation of Adam. The dude's naked and he's touching God.
That's what we're going with. Oh, that's, my God. That's how I see it. Yeah. Have you seen the world through my eyes? Clearly you haven't.
I don't think Corey's seen the world.
So where I was going with that is you look at that or any other given Renaissance painting or like the College of Alexandria or whatever. I'm sure that was very incorrect. But where it's just like everything's... You gotta look at all of it, and it's like all the different little details, and like, you know, it's all there, and you gotta look. Oh, look, like that dot has significance. Like, you know, like fucking, it's crazy. It gets a little, you know. Sometimes you don't need that.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you can just. Sometimes quantity over quality is okay, and that's not to say that it is not quality.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just using that term, and you know, the least semantic of, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
But you put out a lot of simplistic good stuff, and your framing is good, of course. And the way you edit, always, even if it's minimal editing, every time it comes out as something that I look at that, and especially if I know that person, I'm just like, man, this like captures so much. And you're letting... Okay, here's a better way of explaining it.
Mm-hmm.
When you put someone behind that... Or, well, you're behind the camera. When you put somebody in front of that lens, they are those details. You know what I mean? You just capture the painting.
Mm-hmm.
And you capture that painting very well, and you frame it so that the frame is... You know, if you're taking a picture of a painting, it's just a painting. But you... They are the paintings in the pictures.
Yeah.
And you capture that very well. Mm-hmm. And you get that detail. And you get those action shots. And your timing is good, too.
Mm.
And there's so much more to each image than the image itself. There's the context behind it where like, you'll tag where it was. You'll tag who it was.
Mm-hmm.
And it serves as kind of a megaphone for... the fans of those people too, you know, and that can boost those people's love of that person already.
Mm-hmm.
I know I'm totally tangenting again, and we can't keep track of all my tangents, but
no, I think like, I agree with what you're saying. I mean, that's in a part why I started the account and named it Hip Hop C Bus.
Yeah,
is originally it was just like there's a lot of talent that I see in the city. Because I shot shows for, I don't know, a month or two before I started posting anything on that account, before I even created the account. Because originally I was, like, trying to use this to, like, promote the wedding business. That was actually the very first reason I was going to these shows is, like, I'll shoot these shows, I'll get people, they'll see these photos, they'll be like, oh, this guy's good, oh, he also does weddings. Anyway, so going back to the main account, so the reason I named it that is, like, I want to promote all these people, like you're saying, in the city who need a bigger platform.
Yeah.
Which at the beginning, they had much bigger platforms than I did. But I'm trying
That's kind of what we're doing, too.
Yeah, but I'm trying to build it to the point where, like, it can bring awareness from outside the city. Because right now, a lot of the people who follow the account are still within Columbus.
Okay.
Anyway.
That has its value, too, I think. If you, like, sometimes I think about this with our audience as well. If we... keep it within Columbus, there are some limits on that, but also we serve Columbus better.
Yeah, you know? The whole thing is like we're Columbus based because we're created here in Columbus. That doesn't mean that people outside of Columbus, you know, can't still enjoy the show.
Exactly.
We still encourage people from outside of Columbus to listen to the show. We just consider ourselves, you know, based in Columbus because that's where we're from. That's where we're doing the show. We bring people onto the show from Columbus because that's the city that we're from. That's people that we're easily able to like get access to. Plus there's a lot of people that are really like trying to start something in this city. And we want to be a part of this city that is continuously growing.
Speaking of outside Columbus, I checked our analytics earlier and we have one listener from Ontario, Canada.
Shout out to Canada.
Shout out
to Canada.
Shout out the one dude from Spain and shout out the one dude from Canada.
Dang.
We have one from each. So whoever you are.
Thanks for using a VPN to say that you're in Canada.
Yeah, thanks.
you should tell them your Twitter handle so they can reach out and say hello.
Yes, we should really make this more consistent across our social platforms. But on Twitter, we are @gab_street. And do not spell out underscore. It's just a character underscore. But gab_street. Tweet at us. We'll probably... Yeah.
I'm just imagining somebody like starting to type it out as they're listening. And then you say... And then they hear you say, don't spell out underscore. And it's just like, fuck.
Damn it. Why did I... that'd be funny. No, we are. Our listeners aren't idiots. We know they're the big smart
for the most part.
Yeah, for the most part. We're Mr. Spam guy. You're smart. We like you. Okay, well, I don't know what that was, but
I think it was my camera.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah,
I was like, hope that wasn't. Yeah, because that's the noise that my camera makes when it shuts off.
Right. Do you mind if I restart it?
Yeah, if you want to.
Sure.
Yeah.
Go right ahead.
Hello.
Yes. So,
does yours have a 30-minute cap?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's why because I have my DSLR, but it also has a 30-minute cap. This will just shoot for 2 hours straight.
Right. Yeah, DSLRs are a little bit of a bummer for that reason. Although you can, hack them.
Yeah.
That's what I've heard. And, change the software inside.
I'm too afraid I'm going to break something.
Yeah, same here.
Yeah, that's...
Did going back to the question of being unique, did that give you some decent content there?
What do you mean?
Was that a good answer to why I'm unique?
What was your answer once more? I went on for so long.
I don't know.
It was simplicity?
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah,
exactly. Okay. Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
That was good.
Being simplistic.
Yeah.
And, cool. I dabbled in a little bit of photography, but I have a separate account, but it's all kind of just kind of let me throw this into Afterlight and just see how much shit I can throw with it without making it look like a piece of garbage. But
post it.
My stuff is very kind of saturated a lot, but I like your stuff because it is simplistic and it's kind of and your timing is really good too with how when the shots that you do capture of the artist I think is really good, and I think it's hard to get that too.
Yeah, although with high speed shutter it's not as hard as some people think.
Yeah,
I think it's more about, it's not so much the timing, because it's rare that I just push the, I'm waiting for a specific moment and I push the button.
Mm-hmm.
It's more being in the right place, pointing in the right direction, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Do you use burst mode a lot on your shots?
Yeah.
And then just kind of just pick the best one?
Yep.
Yeah. I know some people, but...
Yeah, I guess there still is some timing, because when I first started shooting shows, I would just burst mode everything. This person's still standing here. Let me take some more photos. And I've come to realize, you need to wait for them to start doing something.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think over time, your reflexes get better. And you're okay, they're about to, throw their hand in the air. And then you push it. Hoping that one of the hands going up will look good.
How much sorting do you have to do between all those pictures that are taken in that burst?
Yeah, so at the beginning...
Because I'm sure there's probably, at the end of the night, there's probably a lot of photos that you've got to sort through to pick out which ones you're going to throw up on social media.
Yeah, so at the beginning, I was dumping all of them onto my computer, which I still do, and then going through them one by one in Lightroom and deleting the ones I didn't like, and then re-editing all the ones I did.
Yeah.
And then I was shooting a show, I don't remember how long ago, and I accidentally hit one of the buttons on the back of the camera and it put a star on the photo. I was like, oh. So you can actually rate, at least on Canon, at least on the body that I have, you can rate the photos as you're shooting. So now I don't have to do that on the back end at home.
Nice.
Can you write a review?
Do what?
Can you write a review on there too?
Probably, yeah. I'm not going to write
Canon's
text,
getting rid of their features in their cameras.
Yeah, no, probably not. You can actually go 1 through 5 stars. I just do 1 star.
Really?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
So yeah, usually between songs or sometimes during the song, if I'm feeling lazy, I'll go through a burst and be okay, that one was good. Or zoom in and see if it was in focus, because sometimes the shot looks good on the tiny screen and then you zoom in and it's out of focus. Well, okay, that one was useless. So that saved a lot of time. And usually my keeper rate varies between on a really bad day, it'd be 10%, and on a really good day, 25%.
Yeah. Wake up, I can hear the birds outside, sun shining on our side, life's what you make it,
babe, what you been making lately. Somewhere in there.
Cool. So, is this a camera that you had prior to going into hip-hop photography?
Yeah.
So, because I know you mentioned how there's a lot of low light, the lighting is kind of off, and I didn't know if that determines what kind of camera you use in that environment, because I know a lot of people, for if they're shooting in a low light environment, then they're going to use a camera that's more specified for a low light. I know Sony's A7 series, the A7S to A7 III is really good for that kind of stuff.
Right.
What kind of equipment do you use? The camera that you use?
So the bodies I have are Canon 5D3s.
Okay.
I think the most important thing, I've heard good things about Sony too. I think Sony, Canon, Nikon, most important thing is the size of the sensor.
Mm-hmm.
So people who shoot full frame cameras like the 5D3 or like the fancy Sony A7s, the bigger the sensor, well, I won't go into all the technical stuff, but the bigger the sensor, the less noise you get.
Yeah.
At high ISO levels. So that's the key factor. Mm-hmm. So when I first started shooting weddings back in like 2014 or 15, I don't remember, I had a crop frame sensor, which is fine outside.
Yeah.
But then if the sun gets too low or you try to shoot indoors, like you get up to ISO 800 and it's already starting to look pretty grainy.
Yeah.
Versus this one where I can shoot at 32 and it's still pretty good. 64, it's not really the best, but I can get away with it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's kind of the main thing, I think. No matter what body, if you're going to go into music photography, if at all possible, I would try to buy a full-frame camera. The cheapest one you can find.
Yeah, I use a Lumix G7, which is a Micro Four Thirds sensor. Mm-hmm. And in low light, it's pretty weak.
Yeah.
But typically, it's just kind of like, I just got to make sure. Like, if I do a lot of video work, but most of the time, I just kind of make sure that I'll, like, shoot in 4K and then scale down.
Mm-hmm.
Which kind of works out because, you know, not a lot of people have 4K displays. So shooting in 4K, right, and cropping down, you're going to get a sharper image. And, well, ultimately, it'll look just as good.
Yeah.
And
all of that advice I just gave applies if you're not using flash.
Okay, yeah.
Like, if you're using flash,
right,
then the flash hopefully is powerful enough that you can, even with a crop frame sensor, you could shoot at, like, ISO 400 or 800. Mm-hmm. And it'd be fine, especially if you're shooting the flash directly at people, then you might be able to do like ISO 100.
Yeah.
So sorry if this is too technical for the podcast, but
no problem. Yeah.
He'll go into like when we had
Evan Swiatek.
We had Evan on and
episode 3.
And like Zay Crypto and Luke on. It was most of the episode was just kind of them talking and me just kind of be like, yeah, I listen to Logic.
when we did that episode with Zay, he brought over this poster of Logic that was so you can't see the actual length of this room, but how long would you say that is in feet, would you say, from this wall to this wall over there?
I'd say maybe 15.
15 yeah. feet. So this dude brought a Logic poster that was like 20 feet long.
He got it from like Zoomies or something where he just went in and they were like, we've got this poster. We're going to throw it away. You want it?
Yeah.
And did he give it to you or does he still
have it? No, he still has it. I couldn't take it. I don't have space.
Also, is it the rapper Logic?
Yeah.
The rapper Logic. No, it's just like Logic in general. Like,
just the concept.
It's like, think well. Like, it's still.
It's just a brain.
That'd be cool. I would have that poster in my room.
You probably could if you wanted to wrap it.
I don't want Logic staring at me while I'm going to bed. Logic, shout out to you, you're cool. Sometimes your lyrics are a little lazy. Your flow is really good.
Mm.
I don't want you looking at me while I'm going to bed. It's not what I want. I'm not about that life. Yeah. I don't know. Are you about that life? Is that what you're telling me right now? Or?
I was kind of disappointed in Bobby Tarantino, too. Yeah,
I agree.
I thought it was okay the first listen. I can't listen to every day.
I don't like party music in general.
Mm. What did you guys hear the latest one from Friday?
I have not yet.
No. Oh, okay.
What did you think of it? Preview yeah. for me.
There were some good ones. There's a track with Eminem.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Eminem's verse was really good.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah. Well, I'll leave it at that.
But Eminem. Hmm. What happened?
We're going there right now?
Let's go.
I was hardcore into Eminem back in the day.
I think Gage would rather go new Kanye, old Kanye right now, and then talk about Eminem.
I've got to make shirts on that joke now.
I keep bringing it up, and now he has to design a shirt for it, and it's so funny.
Find us on the Redbubble store, I guess.
If I say anything 3 times, he has to make a shirt of it. That's basically what it is now. That's basically the deal. Yeah. Ken, say something 3 times. Anything.
Three times, three times, three times.
Holy shit, it's a shirt.
I actually like that as a shirt idea.
I've just got the idea of a shirt that just says 3 times.
Exactly. That's what I'm thinking. Gold.
And just a picture of your face on the back.
Yes.
I like that a lot. I think that's great.
3 times, 3 times, 3 times, Kenneth Jackson, 2K19.
It doesn't even say Gab Street. It's just from you. Oh, God. Oh, that'd be great. So, Ken.
Hmm.
Quick transition. I think, if I remember properly, the very first thing you shot was like a festival, and you snuck a camera in. Is that correct? Should we be talking about
that? Talking about
Soundset? Was that what we talked about? Or is that what you sneaked a little? You snuck, sneaked.
Yeah, I don't know if I would.
Film camera.
I don't know if I would say snuck. Is that what I wrote on that caption the other day on Instagram? Maybe that's not even what you're talking about.
Brings giant fit, like shoulder actually, mount yes, camera.
Yes, you did write that down. There was just brings giant. Now, brings in a boombox.
Now I'm curious what I even said. But no, I wouldn't say I snuck it in. It was more like I took a camera that I could get in.
Okay.
Because I didn't have photo credentials to like get a legit camera inside, which I still don't.
Okay.
And I'm going in 2 weeks, so that's kind of a bummer. But maybe next year. We'll see.
Maybe this episode will help you out with getting the clout.
That? Sorry.
The necessary clout.
You know. Oh, here it is. Yeah. I took a tiny film camera, so I didn't sneak it in.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
I'm twisting words.
That's all right.
I'm trying to
ruining
your life. I'm sorry.
But yeah, so that was the first the first thing I ever shot that was music related, I think.
Yeah. Okay. Treat yourself, you earned it. You just gotta treat yourself to my home. You just gotta treat yourself, you earned it. Cool.
Yeah.
So it was like a tiny film camera.
Yeah, it's like really tiny. It's like literally this big.
So it's like an actual film camera?
Yeah, I should bring it sometime. It's this cool, it's called a Minox GT. They were made in Germany in probably like the 80s or something, or 90s. And it's literally this big for people on the YouTube channel. It's that big. It looked like I'm making a gang sign.
Just take a still shot of that and just out of context.
Yeah.
Columbus Dispatch article. Local photographer. No, I'm
right. But yeah, it's really neat. It like folds up and it kind of flips out on some hinges, and there's this tiny lens that pushes out of the camera. And
that's cool.
You can, it's manual focus. You can set the aperture and shutter speed, and it has a little meter in the viewfinder.
Nice. So do you still kind of mess around with film photography, or are you mostly just digital now?
Sometimes, yeah. So like still when I can't get a nice camera into a venue, sometimes I'll take a film camera. So I have a much larger film camera than that that's a lot higher quality on the photos and has like an actual focusing mechanism.
Gotcha.
So I've taken that to Newport once. Do you guys listen to Watsky?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh my God.
Did you go to the show in October?
It
yeah.
just started.
Yeah, that, I think I posted about that and you commented and I was like, hey, I was there too.
Oh yeah. That sounds familiar.
Yeah, I was because
you got him started.
Oh my God.
You got him started on Watsky.
I'm a huge George Watsky fan.
Oh
yeah,
my God.
Like, I get bullied. Like, he's like, but no, I am like a huge George Watsky. I went to
that show.
I went to the show in October with my friend at the Newport and it was absolutely amazing.
Yeah, he's really good. He puts on a good show.
Yeah.
Awesome energy.
Sure,
and his fans are crazy. Like,
yeah.
There are a few shows.
Yeah, his fans are crazy.
Did you see the guy that was trying to like start, he was like trying to start a mosh pit?
No.
And it was
I was on the edge of the crowd. I was never in the middle.
Okay, I was like,
you were just a couple rows back, weren't you?
Yeah, I was like relatively close. I was like maybe three people away from the front of the stage.
Mm-hmm.
But like there was this guy who was just trying to start a mosh pit. And it's always just that one guy, you know, where like he tries to start something, but he ends up just like spilling people's drinks and just like pushing into people. And it's just like, it wasn't a good time, but
But yeah, so for that show, I like tweeted at Watsky, tweeted at his management. Vaguely knew the tour photographer, like sent him a message, and I finally did get a hold of the manager, and he was like, "Yeah, we're good." So I couldn't get a photo pass for my DSLR, so I brought this film camera.
Nice.
And some of those are on the Instagram, and I usually point them out. I'm like, "Hey, this was shot with film." You can usually tell that they're film because they're like really grainy, and sometimes the focus is a little loose compared to my digital stuff. So, but yeah, that's pretty much the only film I shoot.
Do you develop yourself, or do you take it somewhere to get it developed?
I actually mail it to a place in Kentucky.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
There's have you ever been to McAllister's?
I used to live pretty close to there.
Yeah, it's over on Sawmill.
Yeah, I've been there. Yeah. I never take film there because it's a little pricier than the place I mail stuff.
How much is the place that you mail it to?
It's like I think for color it's like $450.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's like.
And that's they allow you to do no scanning. So I just mail it to them. All they do is develop it and mail it back. And then I have, once again, getting technical, but I have
just the negatives.
Yeah, so I have a light table. You know what that is?
Yeah.
And then I have, obviously, my DSLR and a macro lens.
Okay.
And so I just set up the DSLR on a tripod, and then like get the negative flat on the light table, turn on the light table, turn off all the other lights.
So, and then like, just do that and then just
use a tripod with like a timer. Yeah. And then write. And then take it in the Lightroom, invert it, and then edit it.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. It's a little bit of a hassle. So, I mean, that's why. And I actually have now a smaller digital camera that's. So the main thing in concert photography for the places that care about you bringing cameras is if the camera has detachable lenses.
Yeah.
I don't know why that's like the line that they decide to draw.
So if it, you can bring it if it doesn't have
right.
detachable lens. So if it's right. just a fixed lens.
Right. So okay. I bought a smaller digital camera that has a zoom, but the lens doesn't come off.
Gotcha.
So I mean, the downside is the sensor is a lot smaller than my full frame DSLR.
Right.
But the upside is now when I shoot a show, and I haven't really done this a whole lot yet, but when I shoot a show where I can't get photo access, I'll be able to turn around the photos more quickly mm-hmm. than film. Because that's the frustration. Like, you want to shoot, if it's a big artist, you want to shoot the show, edit it, ideally that night, you know, if not, then the next night, and be able to post it on social media so that they, or at least their fans, will see it and maybe share it and kind of get you some exposure.
Yeah.
And I just felt like, with the film shots I got of that Watsky show, a lot of them came out great, but like sharing them a month later doesn't right. really have the same impact.
Yeah. I'm in a photography class right now at my high school. Mm-hmm. So we're pretty much, we don't really deal with anything digital. It's all film photography.
Mm-hmm.
Have you developed your own film before?
Well, when I lived in DC, there was like an art, kind of like, what's it called here? That place in Franklinton. I can't think of it. The big, like, warehouse looking place that's got, like, a bunch of art studios in there. No, not Idea Foundry. Well, kind of similar to that. Yeah, actually, that's a better analog than the other place I'm thinking of.
Okay.
So, yeah, there's a place like Idea Foundry in, or near DC in Virginia that has, like, art classes. And so my wife took, like, figure drawing and I did photography, like, film photography.
Yeah.
And there was a dark room. So I got to experiment with that, like, developing and printing your own stuff.
Yeah.
So yeah,
I've been like getting super into that because the whole process of it just fascinates me mm-hmm. and like doing film photography. Like, there's this place over on 3rd Avenue called World of Photography that I've been going to quite a bit.
Yeah.
I've been going in there I went in there like a couple times last week and I bought a new, Yashica film camera.
Oh, nice.
I think I still need to get like a battery for it but like it has like this really nice smooth metal aperture and like for the
Is it the what's the model name? I think I know which one you're talking about.
I can't remember.
GTN or GSN or one of those?
It might be.
Yeah.
It's
got like a little atomic symbol on the front, maybe? I don't know.
It might be. I can't remember. It's a fixed lens. It's not like detachable.
Right.
But it's fine because I think it's like somewhere close to a 50mm
mm-hmm.
Attached to it,
right.
which is like really good. Mm-hmm. It gets really nice depths of field because you can go to aperture like 1.6 stop or 1.8 stop.
I think it's 7.
I don't think this one's 1.7. I think it might be 1.6.
Yeah.
1.6 or 1.8.
Corey looks thrilled with all this.
He doesn't know what the fuck we're talking about.
Different language right now. I'm listening to an Italian conversation.
I'm going to give a shout out to them right now because they, through the rest of this month and the month of June, if you go into their clearance room in the back, mm-hmm. If you get 3 items, your entire total is 90% off.
Yep.
Which is how I got that camera, because I got that camera, a friend of mine got one, and his girlfriend got a lens, and my friend Mike bought a small telescope.
Yeah.
Mike from episode 2.
Yeah. Actually. Yeah. Yes. So we went there, and the camera was like originally listed for $80, but I got it for $8.
Right.
It was insane.
Yes. Which is a good deal for those. They did not, well, yeah.
So, yeah. Yeah, and I love going in there because there's this guy who works there named Ricky. He went to the same college that I'm going to, and he's went for the same thing that I'm going into. So him and I just kind of shoot the shit about film and photography and lenses and stuff. So
yeah,
if you guys live within that area or in the Columbus area, definitely check out World of Photography on 3rd Avenue. It's amazing. They have so much cool stuff in there.
Yeah, and they're really nice too. Like, I've been there just browsing, and they have cool stuff in the cases, not in the clearance room, like really nice, unique stuff. And I've said, hey, could you get this out? And just looked at it, and they're like, okay, thanks.
Yeah.
Like, I'm obviously not going to buy, like, a $500, like,
right.
little fancy point-and-shoot from back in the day. But.
And they have like, rentals in there, too, that are relatively, they're, like, decent priced for, like, it's, like, $20 for a day, or, like, $30 for a weekend, which is pretty good, for the equipment that you're getting.
Yeah. And their use prices are a little high, I think.
Yeah.
When it's not and marked down. Stuff. Yeah, so you kind of have to wait for like the 90% off sales, I think.
Yeah.
So but, like, this is a real tangent right here.
I love how they had...
It's not me this time.
They had like enlargers and other stuff for like if you were putting together your own dark room, like you can buy stuff from there for... Which I thought, like, my friends and I made a joke. Like, my roommates who I'm moving in with in July is like, there's three of us in a two bedroom. Is like, all right, new plan. We're all three going in one room. We're turning the small room into a dark room. Let's do it.
Yeah, get some bunks.
Yeah, just bunk beds, just cots and bunk beds.
So, with film photography, are you going to do any like a Fight Club action where you splice one like tiny little porn clip in there?
That's one of my favorite bits of the movie. Where you just like, yeah.
Yeah.
I had to throw it in, just because that's all I know about film photography.
Yeah, except you broke the first two rules.
Oh, shit. You're right. Which one's going to come find me now?
So shame.
There's only one.
Tyler Durden.
I'm sorry, I spoiled it.
Spoiler alert.
I spoiled it.
Have you read Fight Club 2, the graphic novel?
No.
Jake
so,
did.
Yeah, so...
Mouse did.
They turned Fight Club 2, rather than doing a sequel movie, they did a graphic novel. And... A friend of mine has it, and he keeps trying to give it to me to read, but he says it's garbage, and I love the movie so much that I pretty much refuse to read this book.
Yeah.
Because it's one of my all-time favorite movies. Mm. And I just, I don't, if the sequel is, I don't know, it's like the Matrix movies. Like, the first one's pretty good. Mm. Do you need to watch the second and third one? No.
Mm.
Not at all. But.
I agree. Yes.
But yeah.
Yes. So, Kenneth, how would you suggest that people who envy your position would get their foot in the door, per se? Mm-hmm. So, what are the steps? What are the baby steps into getting into, you know, knowing the scene mm-hmm. a little bit better, especially mm-hmm. here specifically, mm-hmm. And getting the right equipment,
freelance photography in general.
Yeah, and, you know, getting the right connections for all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah. So I would say, you know, if you want to shoot music, I mean, like we've talked about kind of before you do anything, you know, if you can afford a full-frame camera, that's awesome. Mm. I know a lot of people can't when they're getting started, and that's not a problem. You just start with whatever you can afford, so not a big deal there. But as far as, like, how to actually go about getting involved, I mean, I would say pretty much do the same thing I did. You know, you go, you find... a show that interests you, you go, you take pictures, you meet people, you know, find out who those people are that were on stage, which sometimes you need to do in person because there's no way to find them online because they're so small mm-hmm. as far as their online presence. Send them photos, get them to tag you. That's key to kind of build up a reputation.
Right.
And as you get to know people and follow someone... and you're going to more of their shows, then you meet other openers who are at the other shows, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, I went to that first show that Sam Rothstein pointed me to and met a bunch of people. And then, okay, now I know all these people. Here are the people who I like their music. Okay, I'm going to go to their shows. Okay, oh, there's this other person at this show. Let me talk to them. Let me take pictures of them. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, I feel like that cool. was all over the place. But
yeah, that was cool.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just a gradual process of... meeting people, finding out whose music or personality you like and want to work with, and doing everything you can to be of service to those people. I would say I wouldn't worry about charging anyone for a long time. I mean, I'm just recently starting to charge people for coming to shoot sets, and still not very much at all.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was like a year and a half I shot basically completely free. Other than, like, if someone really felt obligated, they gave me $10. And I was like, okay, fine. Thank you. That was really nice of you. But yeah, that's key. I think another important thing, maybe not important, but I think it's been good for me, is picking a certain scene. Like, not saying I'm going to be a music photographer, because there's so much, especially in a city the size of Columbus, there's so much music going on.
Right.
Like, if I shot everyone producing any kind of music... it'd be hard to build up much of a reputation or like a name because how would you even go to all the shows in 1 week in Columbus?
Yeah.
So I think shooting only hip hop helped me in that regard because then it became very easy when people would share my photos and tag me for someone else in the scene to see it and be like, oh, this is a hip hop related account. Let me see what's going on with this guy versus just like Jackson photo. And then they'd be like, okay, a photographer, who cares?
Yeah. And gives you more consistency too. And consistency is like the most important thing in content making, pretty much. So, yeah. So we try to do every week, Wednesday at 6 a.m. Get on that. But yeah,
I highly doubt anybody is actually.
No one actually listens at 6 a.m. That's just when it goes up.
Right. I don't even wake up at 6 a.m.
I do. I wake up at 5:30 every morning for school. That's what I do.
Gross.
Yeah. Shout out TJ Stouffer, my cousin, once again. He listens at, I'm pretty sure this is him, he listens at 10 a.m. every Wednesday. Huh. It's pretty cool. Pretty cool stuff.
I don't even listen to this show.
What? Are you even a fan? Name five of our songs. Come on. Yeah, you can't. That's right. You're fake.
Can I even name five of our episodes? No, I can't.
Five of our episodes.
No, but I don't know. Like,
that's because I name all the episodes. Musical Mischief, Our Humble Beginnings, whatever this one's going to be
you
called.
You didn't name Our Humble Beginnings. I named that.
Did you name that?
Yeah.
Fuck you.
I hope you I hope you name this one Three Things.
Three Things?
Three Actually, Things with that would Kenneth be great. Jackson.
Yeah.
That's it.
I like that.
Three Things with Kenneth Jackson.
Let's do that. Ken, do you have any shout-outs that you would like to give anyone before we close out? Anyone important to you?
People should know about? My wife for allowing me to go to all these shows and watching our baby when I'm gone. That's pretty handy.
Cool.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
I mean, other than her, there's just too many to name. Yeah. You know, I could name off artists, but I would feel bad about the people that I didn't name that I also like.
That's fair. Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah, so I don't want to pick any favorites.
So what he's saying is, his version of a shout-out is, go check out his Instagram. It's at HipHopCBus, C-B-U-S, on Instagram. He has photos being posted. How often would you say?
Lately, it's been like twice a week.
Yeah.
For a while there, it was once every day, but I've kind of slowed down on Instagram. I'm actually way more active on Twitter. So same handle, HipHopCBus.
Follow him there as well. Yep. Consistently posting, always. And if you are interested in the Columbus hip-hop scene or music scene in general and you want to check out something new, go check out his stuff. I've always enjoyed his photography.
Thanks.
Just check him out. Give it a listen, but you know, that'd be kind of hard. So
yeah.
I mean, if you listen really hard, then maybe
put your phone right here.
Right. And I do want to mention, you know, my DMs are open on Instagram and Twitter. You can also email me at hiphopcmus@gmail.com. So if anyone wants any advice about music photography or photography in general, I'm always happy to chat either in public on those forums or in private.
And can they get a hold of you through the same handles if they are looking for you to shoot something that they might
shot? Oh, yeah, for sure.
Awesome.
Yep.
So remember, thank you, KT. Thank you, Green Room. Thank you, or Fortune Orange. I'm not going to forget it again. And thank you, Kenneth Jackson, for being our guest for episode 14. Is that what it is now? No, 15. This is going to be 15.
Yeah, this will be 15.
Yes. Episode 15.
We're recording this on the Sunday after the Ruth episode.
Yes.
But it'll go up the Wednesday after the episode that we will record tomorrow that will go up on that Wednesday.
We put in the work for you. This is a project of passion.
Yes.
We're here for you. Go check out Fortune Orange. They're super dope. They're from Columbus. They're one of those big jazz-ish neo-soul bands that are popping up lately. So go check them out. Thank you very much. Yep. And we will see you on Wednesday every week at 6 a.m. Don't forget to check out our Ko-fi page and give us $3.
Old Kanye.
Corey's dad won't let me make incest jokes anymore.